Just because others refuse help doesn't mean we have to refuse help. That is key to our situation right now. So I went through a 105-day basically quarantine from culture, ended on January 3rd, 2023, January 3rd. And since then, I've been kind of assessing, you know, where is culture now compared to where it was when I, you know, started the quarantine. The intensive was an intensive, spiritual intensive. And I have a couple of key people that I check in on. And they have slid way down. It's like, uh-oh. Now, these are extraordinary people, but they're caught up in it. And it's taken them down. So quite a great social experiment to engage in. And it's one thing to talk about, it's another thing to do it. So I've actually done it many times. And this one was the most profound. And you say, uh-oh, wow, there's problems here. In high places, there's a galactic takeover of this planet for their own purposes. And seeing that happening, you say, wow, this is trouble on a grand scale that's taking place in this world. And maybe quarantine is the right thing to do, you see? Possible. I thought it came to me this idea, like, hey, it might be the wisest thing might be just to quarantine yourself from this culture at this point, because you have it is really tricky business, to say the least, and you run the risk of being severely compromised. If these people, outstanding people, are being severely compromised, and they are, you know, you got to think twice before getting involved with it. And it may be that we quarantine, actually. I'd say there's a 50-50 chance of that at this point. It's, I can look at it 50-50. There's this spirituality, we call it woke spirituality. And it's very tricky stuff. You take truth and then you mix in lies with it and then present that. It's really sugarcoating lies. And ultimately, woke spirituality is all about getting better outcomes here in this universe, getting better outcomes within the context of this universe. That's not what genuine spiritual teaching is about at all. Genuine spiritual teaching tells us this universe is just a dream. It's not our reality. And that the goal is just to surrender all outcomes, good and bad. Give it all up. And accept the feeling that comes with that, which is bliss. And then bliss reassures us that we can function perfectly well within the genuine reality, the great perfection. So the woke spirituality is on the move, folks. Okay, it really is really on the move. And it's mushrooming so fast. It's of a great concern to me that... it's kind of like, wow, you got to stay away from this. This is dangerous stuff. Because they're blending it. Yeah, there's so much channeled messages going on now, either from galactic this or Jesus this. And, you know, it's mushrooming so fast. So many books are coming out. And they're all trying to tie it into, you know, A Course in Miracles or something that make it seem non-dual, but it's actually completely dualistic what they're talking about. They're talking about, you know, how to enhance the body experience. How to get better results for the body experience and all this kind of stuff. But they'll tell you, you know, they'll quote A Course in Miracles, for instance, and then they'll completely twist it and then add on this other stuff, which is really the opposite of what the Course in Miracles say. And they're trying to make it seem like you can't have one without the other. That this is actually an enhancement of it, so to speak. And this is going on and growing. But it's growing all over the world, this kind of trickeration, to say the least, the psychological trickeration. And, you know, be humble enough to say, hey, you know, I could easily get, you know, crunched up in that stuff. I don't know anyone that is immune from it entirely. I have some immunity, but, you know... I don't want to risk getting infected with this psychological disease. Spiritual wokeism is a psychological disease, a spiritual disease. So I had a dream last night that pointed this out. It was so extraordinary, really. And actually, I started to get into bad habits that I wouldn't have ever thought that I could get into. I was like smoking this cigarette because someone gave me this fancy clip and says, oh, it looks so cool. The clip makes it okay. It was this chick, this woman, who was a friend of a wife of my friend or a companion or something, and she says, oh, here, try this, you know, but use this clip, that'll make it different. So I smoke it, says, huh, people, so people think, oh, you're cool, oh wow, that's okay now. I see that. I said, really, what am I doing this for? And then I found myself in this city, and there was this Afrocentric chick who was hustling me to take this this drug, fentanyl. I said, that's fentanyl. She goes, oh yeah, but it's all cool, man, you know. And I said, what do you mean fentanyl is not cool? I'm not taking fentanyl. What are you talking about? She goes, I know, you know, it's derived from, you know, organic milk, so it's totally organic, totally good for you, man. It's not a problem. I said, what? Well, I said, well, okay, so you've chemically engineered the molecules that make up fentanyl. You've chemically engineered it from milk. You could probably engineer it from a log, you know, these days, right? They can do pretty much get anything from anything these days. And then you're saying that fentanyl is okay for you and it's good for you now because it comes from organic milk. And she goes, yeah. And she totally believes this, yeah. And I'm like, whoa. That was a wake-up call. That was scary. And this wokeism is a psychological spiritual disease. Okay, so they really believe this. That it's like the sourcing is what's all that is important. The packaging and the sourcing is what matters. So it's like if you get a drug from it's sourced from here and it's packaged this way and it's derived from this. You know, we derived it from, you know, the leaves of this tree. You know, it's the same drug. But they say that's okay now. We've made it okay. And they think this is a huge accomplishment. It's kind of like making a lie okay. We've sourced the lie from this source, you know, and now we got the lie from the ocean. Now it's okay for you now. That's what they believe. And this is spiritual wokeism. And these, of course, people are suffering from extreme delusion, extreme paranoia. And this is what goes on in this dream universe, this scheme universe. Actually, it's not a dream universe, it's a scheme universe. It's a charade universe. This is the epitome of what happens here, is that you're expected to do stuff that you know is ruinous for you because it's now sourced properly. That sort of thing. Oh, yeah. It comes from this lab. You know, so if it was like back in the 60s, it's Owsley ass. Oh, okay, it's good for you then, you know. The source is pure or something. This is the insanity of wokeism. This is always going on in this scheme to keep us clinging to the scheme because we're afraid if we stop this charade of pretending limitation and ruination for ourselves, we won't know how to function in perfection. So we're always cooking up these schemes to cling to our pretending. And so this one really got my attention, you know. Wow. She's got the Afrocentric chick is peddling fentanyl now. And how you can't say no to her because what, you'd be racist, you'd be sexist, you'd be sourcephobic, you know, on and on and on. So you would be condemned in woke culture. You would be condemned for not taking this properly sourced fentanyl because you'd be, you know, they say that's sexist. You're not taking it because that's sexist. She's a woman that's asking you to take this, or it's a black woman, so that's racist and sexist, you know. And she's younger, so that's ageist too. You know? In other words, that's the reason why you're saying no, not because you don't want to take fentanyl. You see how they twist it? You see how woke culture is such incredibly twisty, distorted culture. And the Course in Miracles was really a course in reason. And the galactic teachings are courses in emotionalism, actually. Emotionalism is not reason at all. It obscures reason. It obscures it. So when you have really clear reason, you can see through this wokeism. You see, it's utter absurdity. It's utter absurdity dressed up in some new fashion. It's just absurdity wearing a different fashion is all it is. But they say, oh, no, you got to be emotional about it, you know. You got to love it. You got to love it. No, we don't. they don't like reason. Reason comes from the Holy Spirit. It comes from grace. It doesn't come from our intellect. It's not intellect. It's not emotion. It's beyond those. And it clearly can see the difference between truth and lies, between absurdity and sanity. It can clearly see this. So clearly, fentanyl is really, really, really bad for you. You don't want to take it. And yet they claim that not taking it labels you, you know, this bigoted, sexist, misogynistic, racist, whatever, you know, whatever they can label you as. Instead of that, no, it's bad for me. You see how that works? So that's a dangerous, dangerous society. That wokeism is extremely dangerous culture. It'll lead you into extremely depraved condition, because if you feel if you don't do this, that you're evil. If you don't become a fentanyl addict, you're evil. You see how it works? And so this is exactly how wokeism works. Wokeism is an extremely dangerous psycho-spiritual disorder. Extremely dangerous. It's presenting absurdity in new packaging. Galactic packaging, you see. Now, this doesn't come from us. It comes from the ETs, or it comes from the Galactic Council of, you know, Sirius or something, you know. You can't be serious. Oh, yes. It does. You know, it's galactic sources and channeled masters and all. This is just repackaging absurdity, folks. Everyone has grace within them. Then grace brings you to reason. You're able to see clearly. That's called reason. Say, you don't get tricked. So it's this galactic repackaging that's going on, and that is a dangerous, dangerous thing. Now, I can see through it, but the peer pressure is a whole other thing. You know, you can be completely demonized. Who wants that? I don't want that. I don't want that added pressure. It's difficult enough to drop, surrender all outcomes. You don't have to be under this god-awful pressure by these woke maniacs, really. I mean, let's be honest. These are woke maniacs. They're saying absurdity is okay. Absurdity is now the truth because it's galactic absurdity. Oh, yeah. And be really emotional about that so you can't see how absurd it is. That's what all these love bunnies love bombing you into emotionalism. They say, don't worry, we'll love you so much when you become emotional. So you got all these chicks and some guys too that are just love bombing you. This happened back in the 60s, okay, love bombing. And they'll say, we will love you so much, you'll get so much love. All you gotta do is become very emotional. Oh. Of course, then when you become very emotional, you can't tell the difference between absurdity and truth. Oh. That's not good. So today, I could be going to these places where I know there'd be extreme turmoil with the storms we've had. I know the runoff is just going to be intense, like, you know, the Guadalupe River, the lake here, the overflow of the lake, the dam. I could be going to all these places. I know where they all are. I've done it before, and I've taped them all before. And I said, you know what? Been there, done that. I don't really need to do that. I need to be sitting here bringing up this, talking about woke culture and the possibility of voluntarily quarantining ourselves from this because it's so dangerous. It is so dangerous. And, you know, who can claim that they couldn't get pulled down into emotionalism? Who can claim that? Yeah, I'm not going to claim that for myself, say that it's not possible. It certainly is possible. It certainly is. It just takes the right person, and you think, hey, I'll make an exception for this person, and then before you know it, they've got you pulled down into emotionalism, love bomb you, pull you down emotionalism, and then feed you this combination of truth and lies. And now you've just become sort of this puppet, like a cow to be milked for your emotions, or you know, you become a woke idiot. Basically, you can't tell the difference between absurdity and truth anymore. And just like that, it's extremely slippery slope right now. Terrifying, terrifying. Absolutely, it is. Any guy that says he's not vulnerable is a liar. You know, is a liar. So there's a bunch of guys bragging like, oh, you need to quarantine it. Oh, you can't handle it. I said, well, you think you can handle it? You're a liar. Okay. This isn't Ram Maharshi can handle it. Nobody else. Okay. Nobody else. So to speak. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, he could handle it. Not easy. He says not easy, actually. For him, I mean, it's tough. He said the women are tough. Very tough. Very tricky and tough. A real pain. A real pain. He said. But he was able to handle it. Rest of us, no. So, by all means, being quarantining is the wise thing to do. Would be the wise thing to do if that's options available. So, I was swinging my swinging the golf club just a little bit before I taped here. This is by 15.5 degree. Isn't that interesting? 15.5 degree ping, 400 cc G2. So it's a smaller head than normal, 15 degrees, and it's got a very flexible shaft. It's a lady's shaft, actually, which is much more flexible. You see how much that flexes? That helps to close the club face when you're swinging, so you know, prevents the open club face, so to speak. With more stiffer shafts, it's harder to close the club face, and it is easier to hit that big, big push to the right. You don't want that. You don't want a big push to the right. You want it in the middle of the fairway. And so this club's a fairway finder. I call it my fairway finder. And the other ones sometimes can find the fairway, sometimes not. And even the pros, you know, they just swing as hard as they can with the extra stiff shaft. Just a tiny bit off, and the ball's going to be like 2 degrees off to start or whatever, 1 degree. But it starts drifting to the right, drifting to the right, drifting to the right. And before you know it, it's in the weeds or behind a tree or something. Yeah, it's out there a long ways, but it's behind a tree. So I was hitting this, just a dry swing with no ball in it here. Ironing more things out. I'm ironing more stuff out, and it's getting better every day. It's getting better every day. So I'm thinking, you know, what do you do if you're quarantined, baby? You play golf. Yeah. I'm thinking, probably. So I've always had this big push in my life. You gotta play golf. Later in your life, you're gonna have to play golf. I say, why? I don't understand this. I don't have any financial stability or security or any security in the future in this world, actually. Really don't. I say, how's that possible? That's not good. Well, you know, maybe there's a quarantine situation coming up. You know, go play golf. Don't engage yourself in this culture right now. It's too dangerous. It really. And the other, you know, so there's one friend I saw, they're getting into roboticism really severely, tech stuff and roboticism very, very intensely. I say, uh-oh, wow. Intrigued by the possibilities. Just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should do it. You know, just, I could go videotape this, you know, this over, you know, flooding rivers and all this stuff. That doesn't mean I should do it. See, reason tells me, okay, yeah, you can do it. That doesn't mean you should do it or you must do it. Maybe so reason's able to prioritize and tell you what is essential, what is more important. And reason says that this is more important, so do this. So I'm listening to reason instead of emotionalism. Emotionalism would tell me, but it's so exciting to see all this over. Well, it is. Yeah, I've been there and done that. It's very exciting. But it also clouds my clarity about what's essential right now. You see, so reason's able to know, you know, what is most essential. That's why kids don't like adults, because adults are able to prioritize this way. Kids just want emotionalism. I want stuff that's fun and exciting. And, you know, football game is going to start pretty soon in San Francisco. Everybody's decked out here, man. There's so many people wearing 49ers hats and jerseys and everything. There's just a ton of people doing that. You know, so this is 49er country here. So you kind of got to know what's going on. I did check. So I with the 49ers, when I finished my intensive, I checked in and said, okay, so I caught up with them and said, okay, I know what's going on here. So, you know, I talked to people and puts them at ease, like, oh, this guy's a regular guy. He's, you know, but no, I'm not going to watch the game. Absolutely not going to listen to the game. No. No way. But I will read a synopsis of it after it's over so I can talk to people, because everybody's going to say something about it one way or the other, right? And they kind of check, like, you know, are you still, like, going along with culture? And I say, oh, sure, yeah, you know. Yeah, nice game by Bosa, you know, it was great, you know. Yeah, the turnovers turned the game, yeah. Because I'm really good at just being able to get the essence of it and then just say that, you know, so that people don't think that you're not paying attention. But I don't watch the games, no way. way too emotional. Way too emotional. That's super emotionalism football. And just people, just, you know, just they build more and more emotionalism in culture. It's crazy. Not the thing to do. Just like smoking. Oh, look at this elegant clip you have now. And this is how the woman sold me. She's trying to sell me on smoking because there's this new way of clipping it and holding the clip that you look like, you know, back in the days when they were advertising smoking. You look at these magazines back then, they're full of smoking ads. And all the celebrities had smoking cigarettes. And, you know, it was a sign of sophistication. Smoking was showed that you're sophisticated and you're hip. And that's how they sell it to people. That's how they sell it. They're through celebrities. We think we have a celebrity culture here. And so they sell you this stuff. Yeah. Holy cow. So many, many people took up smoking because they've seen the movie stars smoke. And they said, oh, this is what rich, elegant, sophisticated, smart people do. So if I smoke, I'll seem to be that way also. So there's this, some sort of like new way of clipping the cigarette and something that makes it seem like, I was thinking like, huh, this looks kind of like hip, you know, to be doing this. And so here I was puffing away on a cigarette. I'm saying like, what? What? It's so odd, you know. So woke culture can take you where it wants to take you, you know, because it's using the stigmatization if you don't do it. You know, and they make sure that they market stuff to you, you know, with certain people, like, so, like, you know, a black female transgender young is telling you that to take fentanyl because it's sourced from milk, and if you don't do that, you're transphobic, you're racist, you're sexist, misogynistic, bigoted, ageist, you know what I'm saying? This is woke culture. This is the kind of pressure they're putting on everybody here. And at some point you're going to say help, you know, and then you want to like align yourself with someone who's culturally, you know, what do you call culturally woke, like the symbols of wokeism, you know, some young woman who's you know, this and this and this, and then they say, oh, you're with her, oh, you're okay, but in the meantime you're being love bombed into emotionalism. So it's a diabolical thing that goes on here. Happened in the 60s, and you know, but so the guys have just got to align yourself, you know, with the right person, so to speak. So it's extremely tempting, because then you feel like, you know, she'll say, oh, well, he's okay, yeah, he's okay, yeah, I'm taking care of him, don't worry, you know, kind of thing. No, he's not, you know, this, he's not that, he's okay. But then you're being groomed for emotionalism. You see how that, the grooming in this world is for emotionalism. It's a galactic grooming job that's going on. And we're being galactically groomed into emotionalism. They said, men are bad, they're too reasonable. You know, we don't want that. yeah. And the whole of culture is being groomed for emotionalism. You know, this reason is the enemy right now. It's the enemy. Because they want emotionalism are easy to control, and some say that they feed off the emotions of humans, you know, that there's a galactic entities that actually, that they need this vibration, emotional vibration or something, and this feeds them, you know, keeps them, it's like a drug for them. It actually is a drug, to tell you the truth. It's pretty amazing, but you know, like we have opium fields, and now in California it's full of cannabis fields. Holy cow. Yeah, they give you gummies now, THC gummies for cruisers. It makes you feel like a happy on the cruise. So, they, you know, they get the opium of these huge opium fields in Afghanistan and India used to be just massive opium fields in India. Huge, huge industry. From the British East India Company, you know. So they extract the opium, you know, and use it as a drug to make them feel like, oh, this universe, I'm so happy in this universe. It's such a great universe, right? I don't want to do anything about it. I just want to feel this emotionalism about how beautiful it is. That's what drugs do. So, at a bigger scale, you know, just like the British East India Company used India as their slaves to produce opium and sell to the Chinese, galactic sources want to use this planet as like a quote-unquote opium field, the whole planet. They're using humans like opium plants to produce emotion, which is the drug that other galactic entities use to make them feel like they love this universe, they want to stay in this universe. So we're really being viewed as like a huge opium field for these folks. drugs. We're actually a drug that these people are using, these entities are using. The human emotion is a drug for them. And so they demand, just like we demand that you know, an opium poppy grow, and we cut it open at a certain time and extract the sap and all this kind of stuff, you know, like that. You know, they're demanding that we be good little plants and produce all this emotion for them. That's what's going on. That's what's going on. So they're subverting genuine spiritual teaching here in the world, to turn us, then turning us to emotionalism, so then they can extract this emotionalism for their own drug experience, which makes them feel kind of like, hey, the universe is really exciting and interesting. I want to engage with it, you know. Out of fear, of course, that if we stop the charade, which is what it is, it's just a tool we're using to try to convince perfection to confess that it's imperfect. If we stop doing that, we won't know how to function within the context of perfection. So this is what's happening here. We're literally like cattle, you know, like being milked. The cattle is another, but the milk is like a drug. It's like opium for these entities. And so we're just an emotional farm for them, a drug farm for them. This planet is being turned into a drug farm. And that's why they're desperately trying to legalize all drugs here, to keep people more and more and more emotionalized, you know, and they can't use reason. When you're on drugs, your reason goes out the window, You think you're being reasonable, but you're not. You're just being clever. Like caffeine does that. Caffeine makes you really clever. But it substitutes cleverness for wisdom, caffeine. It's very, very... it's a subtle thing, but drugs can be subtle, and they lead you away from reason, and before you know it, you're very emotional. And that's exactly what they want. That's exactly what they want. So that's what's happening on this planet. There's a huge amount of contact between galactic sources and people in this world during the 70s and 80s. There was a phase there, about 10 years or more, 15 years. Massive contact, mostly with women. The women all testified about it. Millions and millions of them testified that they've had this experience. And this was a big push. And now they have now gotten into channeling. They've gotten into, you know, they're now sort of synced up with these galactic sources. So now they're being used to emotionalize the rest of the planet. They're intermediaries in a negative sense between galactic sources to emotionalize this planet, so then these emotions can be extracted like milk from a cow and used as a drug for these galactic entities, so they don't feel like, hey, I'm sick and tired of this universe, I'm going to give it up, because then they say, oh, I'll face total chaos, can't function, I don't have enough creativity to function in reality. This is what's going on. We're just being turned into like opium poppies. And, you know, they mean business. I mean, these corporations like the East India Company, they meant business. I mean, you couldn't mess with them. They had their own armies. They had their own revenue sources. They were brutal and absolutely focused on their profit and what had to be done for it. And, you know, set up all these factories, these huge factories of opium factories. It's all legal back then. And turned the fields into opium fields, and then had all these workers extracting all the opium and then processing it and putting into these big, you know, these big kind of, like, almost like huge mounds of dough, so to speak, and then they put them in then the crates that they use, and they'd ship them over to China. It's opium, and then they'd be smoking opium in China, thinking like, hey, the universe is not such a bad place anymore. You see how that works? So to understand what's happened here, first you have to recognize why did this scheme arise in the universe? Because first, there's the great perfection, which is the prime creator. It extends itself as a spirit. We call it spirit, which is what we are. And spirit has the freedom to play with any idea whatsoever. So spirit said, hey, I want to test my freedom. I'm going to see if I can be free, if I'm free to have this idea of being prior to the great perfection. So spirit, many facets of spirit took up this idea. But when you do that, you don't have any experiencing, because there's no way to be prior to perfection. So you feel like, oh, you know, where's the experience? What's happening? I don't know what's going on. Very confusing. So then these lot of facets of spirit said, you know what? That the great perfection is blocking me from experiencing this because it doesn't want me to be greater than it. And it's, so it's preventing me from, so that therefore I'm not really free at all. You see, and then you say, hey, spirit, I mean, great spirit, great perfection misrepresented itself, misrepresented reality to me, lied to me about it. It's really not perfect. I don't have perfect freedom, on and on like this. And so then there's a trust issue developed with between spirit and the great perfection. The great perfection knows what's going on, that it's not biased in any way, that we're free. It just knows there's no way to be prior to the great perfection. So it knows it's still perfect. And it knows that we have just imagined there's this imaginary trust issue there on our part, but it's not there on the part of perfection at all. So perfection still trusts completely that we are indeed totally free. So then we in order to try to heal this trust issue, we designed this universe to try and entangle perfection with this universe, such that the universe gets pulled down into feeling that it really is imperfect, and then we wanted to confess and recognize and confess to itself and to us that it really is imperfect, and that then therefore we believe, okay, we don't have a trust issue anymore, you see. But as long as it keeps saying that it is perfect, we feel we have a trust issue. But if it says, oh, I really am imperfect, say, okay, now we can trust you. But that's never going to happen. That's never going to happen. So we're engaging with a futile enterprise here with this universe. But we're so used to using our creativity to pretend limitation and ruination, that's an extremely small use of our creativity. We're so used to that. We're afraid if we drop this charade and then we'll be aware of that we're within perfection, we're afraid we won't be able to function. We won't have enough creativity to function, and we'll be overwhelmed and thrown into total chaos. So we're in this dilemma. We're sick and tired of this pretending limitation ruination. On the other hand, we feel if we stop, we'll be overwhelmed by chaos. So the lesser of the two evils for us is to cling to this charade of pretending limitation ruination. And so we use every kind of cleverness to cling to it. And so these galactic sources are now using this cleverness of using us as a drug farm for them to keep themselves inebriated, so they keep clinging to this universe. They go, oh, this universe, we can always get better outcomes, you know, better outcomes, better outcomes. So you have all this woke spirituality going on now. It's just gaining so much traction in the world, so much traction among young people, which is all about, how do I get better outcomes? How do I get better outcomes? Make me happier. I want this. I want riches. I want health. I want the right relationships. I want the right experiences, the right vacations, the right bliss, the right this. How do I get better results? And so they're all into this metaphysics, supposedly these metaphysics, that if you just do things the right way, just claim it, tell your subconscious that's what you want, then the subconscious will provide anything that you ask for in this universe, and you'll get these wonderful outcomes and stuff like that. So this is a new thought. It started in the 19th century, was very strong in the early 20th century, and then has continued on. People think A Course in Miracles is New Thought. It's not. It's actually how to get free of New Thought. But so many people have thought that it's New Thought. They say, oh, this is similar to New Thought. Well, it has to be somewhat similar, otherwise we won't even pay any attention to it. But it actually leads us away from the New Thought movement, which is really a woke spirituality movement, which is obsessed with results. So you have all this channeling going on right now that's telling us how to use your mind properly. Well, Ram Maharshi says the first thought, or the first step we took, was I. And from this I then arose all this other steps, which we call the mind. So the mind isn't primary, it's this I. That was the first misstep we took, was other, okay, let's establish there's this I. And then from there comes all this thinking, which we say comes from the mind. But he says when you focus just on the I, the so-called mind disappears, and then when that does, the actual I disappears, and then it's just I, or I-ing, which is, you know, reality. So he says that the mind is not real. It's not real at all. But the new thought insists that the mind is real. You just have to know how to use it properly. We're not using the mind properly. And we can use the mind properly, then we just have all this happiness. Who has this happiness? Ramana would say. So it's not in alignment with the great teachings in history at all. But A Course in Miracles sort of aligned itself with new thought. But not really. Not really. It was helping lead... helping us back away from new thought, actually. That was Jesus' purpose. He saw what was going to happen. He knew the galactic recruiters were coming into this world to set up this planet as a drug farm for these galactic entities. He knew that was going to happen. And so he gave us a way to back away from the edge, back away from new thought. So it seems sort of new thought-ish, but it's not really. But he had to make it seem similar enough so we would be interested in it. You know, otherwise we'd say, it'd be too strong of a medicine. So he kind of diluted the medicine. He had to. You know, if people say that medicine's too strong, they won't take it. So he diluted the medicine so we would take it. But it's supposed to then be enable you to take stronger and stronger and stronger medicine to realize that new thought is not where it's at all. That's only trying to maintain our clinging to this universe. It's a worshiping of this universe. Instead of saying, hey, this universe is actually a horrible place, it's designed to try and pull perfection down into imperfection, which is impossible. And it's not what I really want. Jesus says, this universe holds nothing that I want. This universe holds nothing that I want. So these new thought people, there's a lot of people, most people who started A Course in Miracles were new thought people. Some of them got it and realized, hey, this is a true message, and it's better than new thought. Others have taken it in a new thought direction and are taking it more and more and more in that direction. You know, better outcomes, that sort of thing. How to use the mind properly. So this is a huge issue, to say the least. Very, very, very troublesome issue. And there's all these schisms happening in A Course in Miracles because of this. All these schisms between those who are taking it in the right way and those who are using it to just promote new thought now. They're using it to promote new thought, dualistic new thought. You know, how does my mind get happy outcomes in this universe? That's not what Jesus is talking about, in my opinion, in the opinion of many. Certainly not what Ram Maharshi's talking about at all. Not at all. So here we are, you know, in this really, really, really tricky situation. So I don't want to get engaged with those Course in Miracles people, because you're just going to get hammered by a lot of people. Some of them might back you up, but a lot will just hammer you, you know, and it's just a situation. So Jesus knew this would happen. He knew it would happen. So again, you know, you have to understand the medicine was watered down somewhat. Now, the people who are into new thought, woke new thought, it's interesting. They go in a certain direction, which is to emotionalize everyone and to worship the universe. Whereas those who are into non-dual, which I believe the real purpose of A Course in Miracles, what I was told was to look at Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell. And this was even more adamant. This was a stronger medicine than A Course in Miracles. It's stronger. But after 15 years of A Course in Miracles, or 15 or 16 years, I was ready for it. And Jesus said, you're ready for the next step. And I said, okay. And I found, this book found me. I walked into a bookstore and I just, you know, walked over to, they had A Course in Miracles for sale. And there's another book, what's this? And I said, Journey Beyond Words. I looked and I said, oh my God, I love this. Right away, it's love at first sight. And so I studied that for a year and have kept on, you know, referencing it for all these years. It's a much more adamant presentation. It's stronger medicine. But because of that, the new thought people, they'd hate it. They don't like it. Very seldom is it ever mentioned in A Course in Miracles. They all talk about other books, A Course in Love and Course of Mastery and A Disappearance of the Universe, all these other books. Rarely is Journey Beyond Words mentioned. Rarely, rarely, rarely. And some of them hate it. They say it's totally egoic. Totally, really? So you can tell where they're coming from. Very emotionalized places where they're coming from. The Journey Beyond Words is a graduate course of A Course in Miracles. And it is extraordinarily wonderful. It's not totally perfect. I mean, you can get stronger medicine, which we give out here. We give even stronger medicine here, but it gives out really strong medicine and tells you, wow, this universe holds nothing that I want whatsoever. And, you know, I need do nothing, I am light, wow. I need do nothing, I am light, wow. Jesus is more adamant in Journey Beyond Words, more adamant. Less catering to new thought emotionalism. Doesn't cater to it almost at all. Well, very little. Very, very little. Very little. There's still a little bit of that, but very little catering to that. So I said, yeah, this is great. You know, that was just fabulous to come across that book. But I was shocked that other people don't like it. You know, they just like, they ignore it. I said, what? Obviously, they're still got some hankering after new thought, right? They're still thinking like, hey, we can make this universe a great heaven on earth here. They're still stuck in that syndrome. You know, they don't realize they're getting played by galactic sources to become emotionalized. They may sound real spiritual to start with, but where I can see it's going is emotionalization. It's all about, you know, your emotions and your love, they call it. And how you can find happiness, like, oh, I'm so happy, I say a nice leaf, isn't that beautiful? You stay in this emotional state instead of bliss, where bliss, it feels equally the same everywhere. There's this feeling of always equally everywhere feeling. It's a screen-like feeling. It's the screen-like feeling we need to experience in order to regain our trust in perfection, and functioning in perfection. And so the Greek teachers say, take your attention off of the world, all the stuff of the world, all this external stuff. Take your attention entirely off of that, like it doesn't exist, has never existed. All of them, the great spiritual coaches say that. And here's new thought saying, no, you need to engage more with the beauty of nature. So those two teachings are they're complete opposites, you know, complete opposites. And it's very tempting, you know, because, yeah, you can go out with your camera and take beautiful pictures of flowers, which I've done many, many times. My whole life I've been taking pictures and video and, you know, beautiful nature. But that's not it. That's not it. You can make beautiful graphics, you know, all sorts of spirally fractal graphics and all this kind of stuff. Wow, that kind of thing. They're making some terrific graphics. There's no question about it. They're making amazing graphics. I've come across some stuff that is just mind-blowing, the graphics they're coming up with now. All the spirals and, you know, intricate DNA-like graphics that, you know, all this, it's just extraordinary. But that's not it. That's not the answer at all. So these galactic folks could put on a song and dance for us. There's no question about it. With these sophisticated graphics that they're presenting, I went through them and looked. I said, that's enough. You can get sucked into that stuff. It's a wow factor. It's a big wow factor, what they're able to do now. Some of these digital artists are just presenting stuff that's just jaw-dropping. You know, it's from aesthetic standpoint. But that's not it. That's not the screen-like feeling that you're looking for. You're still going to be entrapped within this context of this universe, which is, again, our pretension, our play-acting pretension of, you know, we're subject to limitation and ruination. Everything is. And that's reality. It's not reality. It's a scheme to convince its perfection that it's imperfect, so it confesses this imperfection to us so we can heal this trust issue. But this trust issue is built up on a false premise. It's bogus. It's not true. There's no cause for it actually at all. It's just we got our feelings hurt, so to speak, when we couldn't experience being prior to reality. We had a temper tantrum. Okay, we kind of freaked out. But we can see that now and say, oh yeah, okay. So freak out happens when we do that. Okay, that's it. So freak out when we do this, freak out happens. We'll have a good laugh at that and that's the end of it. We don't need to go into the silliness of claiming that we have a trust issue with perfection over this. Well, you know, once we get over this whole situation, we won't do it again. We'll have matured, so to speak, truly matured as spirit, realizing, yeah, if I try to do that, I'll freak out. Okay, so don't do it. Or realize, okay, I'm freaking out over this, but don't develop a trust issue about this at all. And then we'll have, you know, that essential safeguard going forward. Yeah, it's the rain has stopped. It was really raining this morning, but the Pacific Ocean. Thank you, Pacific Ocean. You know, absolute gratitude. I've been praying for this succession of storms for quite some time. I realize that's the only thing that's going to help us. I said, we don't want one storm. We don't want two. We need a whole series of storms here to break the stranglehold of the drought on California. It's the only way. And here we have now, this is the 10th storm in succession, and we have one more on Monday, which will be the 11th storm in a row. In like a, you know, a short period of time, 3 week period of time. But they're spaced out. I mean, there'll be a band of rain, and then it'll give like 5 hours of no rain or something. There'll be another band, and then another 5 hours. Or there'll be, you know, or there'll be a break of like 1 day or day and a half, and then the next one comes in. So it's kind of just being done extremely well. Really, the timing on it is just fantastic. It's wonderful to prevent, you know, extreme flooding. The rivers are cresting. The Russian River, I think, is a, you know, normal flooding there. They're used to this kind of stuff. It's not horrific. It's not horrific at all. There's no horrific flooding going on. There's no horrific consequences going on at all here. It's a minimal damage, minimal consequences. And given the importance of it, you know, nobody should be crying about this at this point. We should all be very thankful that the Pacific Ocean has given us this unprecedented series of storms like this. And, you know, here it's just like, you know, the creeks are high, but then they go down after. You know, it's a wonderful how it's done. The storms are gentle. They say, ah, terrible storms. No. Hasn't been that way. A few areas got, you know, heavy surf, but by and large, you know, I'd say, you know, it's an A+ job by the Pacific Ocean here. A+ job, and we're saved from a horrible situation in California, and a nightmarish collapse of California in the West. Now, there's still problems with the Colorado River Basin, because it hasn't, for some reason, it's not been getting these storms. I don't understand why. It should have got these storms, you know? The Sierra's got these storms. That doesn't help the Colorado River Basin, which is, you know, the dam was at Lake Mead, and the various dams and reservoirs that produce hydroelectric power and water for, you know, 50 million people or something, that hasn't been helped. So that's still really problematic. So, you know, but at least California, you know, we've got our reservoirs filled up. But it's pretty, you know, they're getting better, and the snowpack is like 200-300% of normal. It's way up there. So, you know, I said, you have to get started in January. Don't wait till February, March, because then, you know, it's going to be a drought. You got to get it going. You got, you know, late December, which is what happened. Late December, got going, hasn't stopped. And we'll finally get a good sunny day on this Friday, you know, this week. After, I think Tuesday will start clearing out a little bit, and gradually we'll end up with some sunny days. You know, now more storms, it would be, you know, a great bonus. So if we get like about 4 or 5 more storms coming in, you know, we get the snowpack, you know, way up, and then get the runoff into the reservoirs and get those filled up. And then, you know, we might survive for another 2 or 3 years or something. So, you know, good things happen. That's a good thing, you know. I mean, so we're not anti good stuff happening at all. You know, go along to get along. You don't want a catastrophic drought here. But we're not obsessed with getting good outcomes. We are focused on, you know, just loving this feeling of dropping all outcoming wow. Just loving the feeling of dropping all outcoming wow. Just loving the feeling of dropping all outcoming wow. Just loving the feeling of dropping all outcoming wow. Just focus on that. Perfectioning is perfection is perfectioning. Wow. Just loving the feeling of dropping all outcoming. Wow. Just loving the feeling of dropping all outcoming. Wow. So, speaking of outcomes, you know, I still want to get good outcomes with this club. The fairway finder. Okay, he's my fairway finder here. There's a lot to it. You know, the stance. My feet are like this, you know. I don't have them way out like that. I don't have one back this way. Or I'm not open stance, not closed stance. Completely parallel. The feet are completely parallel to the perpendicular to the target. and not too far wide, not too narrow, not too far, just standard width, shoulder width, completely perpendicular target, parallel to one another, not like this, and no funny business going on. Everything just lined up this way. And then for our stance goes, I keep my head straight. I started with the driver, I'm gonna do this, just and get left shoulder up, right, drop the right shoulder down, so I'm like this. Instead of like this, I'm now like this. But the head, I decided not to go like this. That creates too many problems, actually. So I just like this. Just like this. With the driver and then the 5-wood and the hybrid. Just like this. Everything else is just total standard. Total standard. And then, you know, you make sure that the grip is right so that the club face is not going to open or close when you power through it. Which is a trick. You got to have the right grip with that. Which I use the baseball grip here, which is the thumb wrapped around, and then I use a single interlocking like this, and then I lock the side of my, you know, this top here and the side of this, I lock that together and adjust weak or strong grip just right here that way, so the club face doesn't move at all. It's really locked in this way. It is very locked in and can't move. So I got the posture right, and then I use my right elbow and attach it to my body, holding the club shaft. I also have an upright position for the body and the club shaft. Instead of the hands being lower down, they're higher up. My wrists are kind of bent towards the ball, that like that. So it's a very, very, very upright stance and a shaft of the angle. Angle of the shaft, not shaft of the angle, angle of the shaft. Then the right elbow touches the body to get the right ball position so it hits the sweet spot, because there's a tendency when you swing, I tend to pull the club a little closer to me, which will hit the ball on the toe if you do that. So by putting the elbow to the body, that pulls the club into where it's probably going to be when I swing. And then I take the elbow off of the body a little bit, just normal stance. But that's how I distance myself properly. And so I'll hit the ball in the sweet spot. So when all is that ready, then you're ready for the swing. And what you do is I take it back kind of low, fairly low, slow, but enough of maybe medium pace, not real fast, not too slow, but not too fast either. Kind of like this. And I kind of stretch it out as far as I can go without moving my body. I'm still straight like this. Stretch as far as I go. And then I pull a little more, and that lifts my left heel a little bit off the ground. The heel goes a little off the ground like that. Just a little bit. And I stretch heel off the ground. Then I set my heel back, which sort of pulls my body back a little bit. Just a little touch. That triggers then the swing. And I keep my right heel on the ground pretty much until I've swung through and let the follow through. Then pull my right side along. Don't push off with the right foot and lift the heel of the right foot too soon. That'll mess you up bad. It'll mess you up. So that's it. That's the swing. And don't obsess with keeping the head right on the ball. Just keep your eye on where you want to hit it. Keep your eye right on where you want to hit it, but don't fixate. You know, once your eye's right on where you hit it, and when you swing like this, then let your head be pulled with the swing. Otherwise, you keep it down there, you're gonna have problems. So, you know, don't obsess with just keeping your head on the ball for too long. That's a mistake. So you put, you know, all those parameters together, and then your swing works pretty well. You know, well, it is what it is, what it is. You don't want to say anything. It is what it is, what it is. but those parameters are helpful. Let's just say these are helpful parameters. Swing results may vary. It's helpful parameters, though. Because, you know, you can always throw something in there that you don't want to. But by and large, you know, you make sure all these parameters are there. And then aligned, and then, you know, you're going in the right direction. How do we put it? I just probably don't want to put it in anyway. It's better than not having these parameters. Let's put it that way. It's better to have these parameters than to not have them. Because always that, I want more speed, more, you know, more power, hit it farther, okay, things like that. Then you start making adjustments to try to get that extra little something, and this can start screwing everything up. So sometimes you just gotta, you know, just accept what, you know, accept the distance that you're getting and say that that has to be good enough, you know, for now. Well, I can put a little, I'm gonna try putting a little wrist at the top, a little wrist cock like that, and give it a little more whip through. That might give it maybe 2 or 3 more miles per hour or something like that. But if that becomes, I'll try that out. I'll try it out. Yeah, that's the one thing I haven't quite added yet. A little more power. You always want a little more power off the tee. That's the psych out of golf. You know, it really is. Everybody's looking for 2 or 3 more yards, yeah, or whatever, you know, 5 more yards. And that messes you up. It messes you up. This is a problem. You're getting these guys who are more and more athletic now that just crush it. You know, and the average person, man, you just feel like, wow, how can I possibly do that? And so everybody's just trying to not be feel so inept, you know? If you hit it 240, you're hitting it really good. You're hitting it really good if you hit 240. Okay, so that's my benchmark. I want to hit it 240. That's a good thing to know. I never quite told myself that exactly. You know, accept it. 240 is what I'm aiming for. I'm not trying to get anything more than 240. I'm just doing, let me hit it right 240. Gotta live with it, man. Gotta live with it. Otherwise, you're going to be chasing 250 for the rest of your life. And if you get 250, you'll be chasing 260. It never ends. It never ends. And it messes you up. Messes your back up. Messes everything up. Your swing. Just say, this club, I'm going to hit it 240. I'm going to say hallelujah. And then I'm going to have the next club, what is it, 100, another 160 yards, 158 yards in. Good. I'll take a 5 hybrid, and I'll hit that 160. Okay? I won't hit it 170. I'll hit it 160. And you know, live with what, you know, is going to work for you in the big picture, in the long haul, and the percentages and everything else. And don't go for too much glory, because you'll be chasing glory forever in this way. You know, I want to hit my 5 hybrid. I want to hit it 180. I should be able to, the pros hit it 210. You know, I got to hit at least 180. You don't want to feel like you're a weakling or something. But these pros are like freaks of nature. You got to understand this. These people are like animals. You know, their strength and speed and stuff and coordination. They're ferocious. They're, you see them, I mean, just your jaw drops and you say, what in the world is this? I remember watching Sergio Garcia hit like a 2-iron off the tee at Harding Park, right behind him. It sounded like a gunshot going off. It's unbelievable. So I'm getting all ready and doing all those warm things like this. And they just, kaboom! And the ball just took off. It's the most beautiful thing, you know, you've ever seen. It's like, what? The ball, you know, goes to where, I don't know how far he hit it, like 300 or something. It was ridiculous how far he hit that ball. Right down the middle, just piece of cake. What? And he didn't seem to have any problem doing it, you know, difficulty or anything like that. He has a freak of nature. It's just so bizarre. So there are these people who can make you seem like you're just a weakling, that kind of thing. You just got to tune that out, man. You just got to tune it out. Don't go chasing distance. You know, work on making, chipping in, you know, chip in and make your putts, so to speak. And don't try to, you know, do too much. So I'll just work on my 240 yard swing with this. I say, okay, this will give me 240, which is really good, really, really good with this club. And that would be really accurate, 240 with accuracy. You know, now you're giving yourself an opportunity to use your hybrids for approach shots and, you know, get on the green and start making some putts and stuff, you know, like that. Giving yourself the opportunity. I know it's psychologically, it's hard to do that. I'm trying to get myself to accept that, you know, accept that 240. And then with the other driver, I could hit it probably two, a real good one would be 260 probably. A really good one, so 260. So I'm either 260 or 240, and just that's it. Cap it at 260. Forget about anything else. Maybe it's fun, you know, occasionally to just try to absolutely max out one, but of course it's fun. What else, who could resist? Right? Who could resist? But that starts messing you up. That's when you start hitting bad shots. It messes you up, trying to just completely max out. That's like with the guys at the home run derby baseball. When they engage in that, and if you win it, and they're just trying to hit the ball on the upper deck, you know, to put on a show for the fans, it messes up their swing. The rest of the year, their swing is all messed up. I've seen that happen over and over and over and over again. It almost always happens because it messes up their swing and their timing and everything. So don't try to, you know, do too much. Except, okay, 260, the max what is my driver, an 8.5 or something. And I got it set up for 10.5 maybe. But I mean, the 260 is really good for my age. That's really, really, really good, 260. Forget about 300. That's a pipe dream. That's going to mess your back up, your hips up, your knees, you know, your wrists, everything. Your game's going to go to pieces. I hit it 300. You know, how's your game? You know, don't have one. Better to have a game than to have, you know, hit one 300. But... Yeah, I was tempting. Everybody wants to say, I did that. That kind of thing. I did once when I was younger. I was obsessed with that. So I can do that too. I'm not such a weakling. Because these pros make you look like you're a weakling. It's crazy. It's just these thin, wiry guys, you know. They can whip that club like lightning. It's crazy. I mean, like, stick 6'4", and all they do is they spend time in the gym and working out and doing all these sports-specific exercises. And they are just so, I saw a guy, his turn, you know, they're so lithe, you know, their bodies and stuff. The hip turn was like lightning. You could hardly even see it. It was so fast. It's just insane. And you got these brute type of guys, too. And the gals, too, can hit it really far. And that's another thing. I've got to hit it at least as far as the gals are hitting it, you know. But they also are very sinewy and stretchy and can pivot extremely fast. You know, they can hammer the ball, too. They can hammer it now. But they're competing with the guys, you know. They try to make you look like you're a weakling if you can. No. Just be wise. I'd rather be wise than try to chase after somebody's other definition of a weakling. You know, try to live up to that. You know, that's their problem. You know, it's insecurity on their part. So, 260, 240. You know, just live in that area. If you hit it 260, then let's say a 400-yard hole, you have 140, and then you go to work, you know, with a, you know, 7-iron or an 8-iron. And if it's a shorter hole, like a 370-yard hole, you hit it 260, you have 110 in. And then you get your, you know, 110 would be like a hard 52 or a soft pitching wedge or something like that. And then, you just go like that. Just get it in the fairway. That's the key. That is the key. So there's your golf lesson. Free golf lesson. Free golf lesson. Got a friend who's really sick right now, and I want them to know that, hey, you know, get well and you get a free golf lesson from me. I'll actually fix whatever you want fixed. I probably could at this point. I've paid attention to the golf, what needs to be done for so long. I probably could help them out a bit, but everyone's unique is the problem. You can't just snap your fingers and fix somebody. You got to rewire your expectations. You know, it's a matter of rewiring your expectations. It really is, and that's a difficult thing to do. Everybody's swinging the way they do for a reason, because that's where their expectations are. You change your expectations, reshape them. Then you're able to do stuff like the different grip. You say, well, I can't do that because everyone's always told me, don't give a baseball grip. That's only idiots do that. Not true at all. It works way better for me. If it works better for you, that's the right grip for you. As a long, old school salesperson in a golf store told me, hey, I said, I want to look at that new TaylorMade. He said, why? I said, well, you know, it's new. It's supposed to be really good. He says, hey, look. The best driver for you is the one that you like the best, and it works for you the best. That's the best one. It's not necessarily a new club. He told me it's not necessarily going to be a new club or this club. He said, what works for you best? I said, wow, that's great advice. Same thing. You know, what swing works best for you? is what grip works best for you. But at least know your options. You know, I know I can now do single interlocking or overlapping if you want, double interlocking, double like this. So single, none would be like this. Single would be like this. I can show you on this. So none would be like this, just like that. Total baseball grip, you know, total baseball grip. Single would be interlocking one finger, little finger here. Double would be interlocking two fingers like this. So that moves this right hand up the shaft. So you see regular, you see where the hand is, or none is way up here. Interlock one, the right hand's further up the shaft. Interlock two, it's further up. Interlock three, look how far up it is now. That would be a three interlocking thing, which I use for my pitching, bump and run pitching with a nine iron. That's a triple interlocking grip. Right hand's way up the shaft, so it's not really able to have much power to twist the club. If you got it way down here, this right hand's so strong, it's got so much a grip on the club, it can twist it. The more you do go interlock, the less that the right hand can twist the club. And the whole problem with golf is the too much right hand, you know, too much dominant hand. With your left hand, would be the opposite probably, but too much dominant hand tries to take over, you know, and that messes up your golf swing, So it's weakening the right hand is what you're doing when you're changing these grips like that. And so you really should be very fluid in these different grips. So I said, you know, most people are not. They just have one grip and that's it. But if you're fluid in these different grips, you can make adjustments as necessary, and you find, hey, maybe this works better for you. And then, you know, choking up on the club, you know, you go up the shaft. So regular grip would be, you know, here, the sort of shaft like that. Probably better leave like half an inch here. And then choking up, you would, you know, leave like 2 inches or 2.5 inches or something, choke up on it, like 2 inch choke up like that. And that's shortening, you know, the shaft length for you. And then choking down on the club would be go take my little finger off of the end of the club like this. You see, little fingers off, and just gripping it with these three fingers. So you just these three finger grip, and then, you know, and then like this. So that this would make the club, you know, longer for you. I do that with the driver sometimes. It makes it longer and a little less accurate. Yeah. So it's kind of like reworking your expectations, you know. Just settle with the number and just play to your game like that. It's tough because you got all these people bombing the ball. Everybody tries to bomb it seems like. Except some of the women, you know, they're actually, you know, smarter about it. Some of them, yeah, they are. I played with this couple, and the women's really was really good, but she just hit her number. She said, this is where I want to hit it, this is how much far I want to hit it, and just do it. And she just stuck with that the whole way through. And that kind of inspired me to say, hey, you know, let me just stick with this, you know, club and just get it in the fairway straight. And she did really well by doing that, you know. It didn't have, she didn't feel like she needed to put on a display of strength, you know, gotta hit as hard as I can. She goes, no, I'm just gonna go within myself, well, you know, what, so I don't hurt myself, and just do that. So I said, okay. That's helpful. But you get with the young guys who are just crushing it, you know, and you feel like really, it kind of deflates you, you know. It's like, oh. Because they just wail on it, you know. It's crazy. It goes over to the next county, though. It's like, whoops, you know, that one got away. I don't care, just reload, you know. It's like, we go, yeah, well, you know, it's kind of like, if you get in the fairway, you know, you're liberated from birth and death. If you go into the woods, you know, you can have another birth. You better get it in the fairway. You know, mess around. Oh, my goodness. So, the ball position, you know, you want the hands kind of ahead of the ball, like this, the club's like this, and levels of the ball, or club hands are a little behind the ball, so the club face is like, angle more upwards, kind of when it comes in, it's more angle upwards like that. These little variations, you know, change the flight of the ball, how high it goes. When the hands are in front of the ball, it's kind of more of a knockdown shot where the ball goes lower. You get a lower trajectory. But if you know, if you hit it hard on an iron, it's going to go further. Probably it's going to go further when it has a lower trajectory like that. That's why a two iron goes farther than a pitching wedge, a lot further. So you could vary the distance you hit each club by doing that. And if, for instance, you have a club you're feeling really comfortable with on a certain day, like a pitching wedge, you got a 130, and you say, okay, let me hit the hard pitching wedge, which means you put your hands ahead of the ball, and lower the loft angle of the pitching wedge, and it would, and instead of this, it would be kind of like this, so it'd be more like a 9-iron you're hitting a 9-iron. So you can hit a 9-iron at 130, but you can also hit a pitching wedge at 930 if you do this. And so if you have a club that you feel used to, just do that. You know, some people get a favorite club and say, I just want to hit this every time. You can get away with that. I used to be able to do it with an 8-iron. Could hit an 8-iron really far if I wanted to. Or not so far. It's like that. Some people find this, like, you feel comfortable with one particular club. You can make turn it into 3 clubs. You can then get a pitching wedge, put your hands behind the ball more, make the pitching wedge, you know, higher angle, more like a 52-degree wedge, and then you'll hit it like, 90 yards or something, or 100 yards. Or like a normal pitching wedge, maybe you hit it 115 or something like that. So that's really like a 30-yard range you could, hit a pitching wedge. But most people are just, trying to not get, trying to just not get too beat up out there, and it's so overwhelming that you can't really dial it in. This is the problem with golf, is in this universe, you just feel like it's just, I can't dial in what's going on here. It just hits me from every angle. And that's like golf likes like that, man. It's just like, wow, when the wheels start coming off, things just compound, you start panicking, you start overthinking, you don't know exactly what to do, but if you got to go and, rework your expectations, going with the plans, 240 is my number today. So I know what my number is, I know what my stance is, I know what my ball position is, I know what my grip is, I know what my angle, shoulder tilt, I know what my shoulder tilt is, I know what my swing trigger is, okay? So let's go to work. Let's do all the things that I know that I have to do, and let's just hit a 240 on the number here, yeah, like that, and go from there, and go one shot at a time. How's your golf game? I don't know. It depends on my next shot. So then you've left with 145. Okay, 145. Do I want to leave it short? Or do I want to hit it long or in the middle of the green? Maybe back of the green. Kind of try to hit it long, 145. Take a 7-iron then. Take a 7-iron, and see if you can just hit it right in the middle of the green, back of the green. Depending on the lie, do you want to sweep it, or do you need to hit down on it, or do you want to just kind of medium angle of approach? And that you'd be hitting, depending how strong you are, you have to think, how strong are you feeling? And you want to use a double overlap or a single overlap. Single overlap, do you want to choke up a little bit, or you choke down? Maybe I would, 145, I might do a single overlap and choke up a little bit on the club. Single overlap, so I go single overlap, choke up on the club to hit it 145 or something. I don't want to come up short, so you just do, you say, okay, let's go with a single overlap, but choke up on the club like this. And this is my 7-iron, 145 to 150 kind of swing, like that. And so that gives you a little more club than an 8-iron, because so you kind of want to play to go to the back of the green. Because on about 90% of misses are short for amateurs, about 90% are short. So to play the percentages, you want a little extra club coming into greens. You see, so you got to know those things. You got to know the percentage. The percentage that they've shown statistically, if you aim to the back edge, the center of the green this way. Okay, but the back edge center line. The line is the center of a green, but you want to go to the back part of the green. If that's what you're aimed, just aim there. the percentages are vastly, you know, improved for you, vastly improved. Because there's very little trouble right there. You know, some will put a bunker right there, of course. Yes. And that makes it a little trickier. That's not fair, but you need to, you know, anyway. That's it. That just so you know, okay, this is what I wanted. This is just, you know, what my game plan is here. Just hit it to that place. Don't go pin seeking it out. Forget about the pin. Forget about the pin. Just get that number to the back of the green, and then be, as Tiger Woods says, great advice, be aggressive to the your target. Be aggressive to your target. There's only one thing, I'm being aggressive to my target, and just do that. And he says that vastly will help your game and improve your confidence. Because you go pin seeking, you know, you're a little bit off. You know, they have all sorts of troubles over there. You try to hit it a little too hard, you pull it. Now you're down a hill in the rough and you short-sighted yourself, and now you have to hit a flop shot up the hill, kind of flop shot. You muff the flop shot, and now then you're three putt, you know, next thing you know, one, two, three, it's six, you got a double bogey right there, just like that. So hitting it back of the center of the green, you're taking double bogey out of the picture, pretty much, is what you're doing. And they say that the best way to improve your score is to take the double bogey out of the picture. That's the very best way, not by making a bunch of birdies. That's not how you're going to do it. So you take double bogey out of the picture, then you're going to start, you know, occasionally, you know, making putts and stuff, and then your score is going to get a lot better, and you're going to be playing a lot better. So same thing with spiritually quarantining here. Spiritual quarantine, it's like taking double bogey out of the picture. You got to do it. You got to take double bogey out of the picture. If you're wise, and a lot of young people, I know when I was young, I wouldn't do it. You know, for sorts, I don't know. There's not much I can do for young people. It's a problem. They're not wise enough. I wasn't. It's just too tempting. I'm going to shoot at the pin. I'm feeling good. I'm going to take a shot at this pin. You know, it's like 120. I'm going right at it. You know, oh, I hit it a little fat. Oh, it went, or it ballooned on me a little bit. You know, I had a little too much loft on the club. Oh, it went 110. It's in the bunker. You know, it's in the bunker. Oh, shoot. I got a sand shot. Oh, it's kind of plugged up against the, oops, or it rolled down into the valley. Oops, hard to get the ball lofted out of there. Boom, you hit it. Oh, no, I hit it too thin. Went over the green into the back rough back there. Oh, shoot. Now I got to hack it out of the rough and try to float it down there and stop it out of the heavy rough. How am I going to do that, you know? Got to get a lofted wedge. You hit it, chunked it, you know, too short. And, okay, now I got to get this putt close, you know. And so now you're just sweating, you know, you're sweating. You're just sweating at this point. Oh, I rolled it 4 feet past, you know, okay. Now I got to make this for a double. To avoid a double bogey, I got to make this 4-footer. And this is when you start, you know, kind of getting nervous, like, holy cow, I got to make this. Now, we want to be putting, have a 4-footer putting for par. Okay, that's what we want. And if you miss it, okay, bogey. Oh, well, all right, I can, you know, I can live with that. You can live with a bogey. You can't really live with a double bogey. And certainly not with a triple. When you get a triple, you just feel like, you know, you just feel so terrible. You know, it messes you up. Can't live with a triple. Really sad to live with a double. But you can live with a bogey, say, you know. And par, great. Par's great. Par's great. Occasionally you're willing to birdie. That's fabulous, you know. But take the double bogey out of the picture. So we're coming looping back now. Using golf as an analogy, looping back to our situation, is we got a treacherous golf course of the world right now. In fact, it's uniquely treacherous with the globalization of social media and the internet and data and everything, police state. It is the most treacherous golf course ever here on this planet. And double and triple bogeys are everywhere. You know, every single hole, it's like Augusta National. You know, if you don't know how to play that course, you got double and triple bogeys just waiting for you. And so you say, wow, how do I take double bogey, you know, minimize it? This is a question right now. Pick a number, you know, pick a number. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to hit 240. Augusta National, I don't care. I'm hitting at 240. And I'll take a while, you know, I'm going to stay within my self game. I say, what am I hitting now? Oh, I'm hitting a... I'll take a 5-wood, okay? And let me smack a 5-wood up there. You know, either 240. You got another 230 to go. Or 220 to go, or whatever. They may hit a 5-wood. I'll get up near the green. Then you're getting short 20 yards of the green. Fine. Then I'm taking a 9-iron. I'm just going to bump and run it up towards the flag. I'm pretty darn good at that. So I'm going to get it within 10 feet probably, for sure. So then I'm putting 10-footer for par at Augusta. 10-footer for par. You see, I can live with that. Because, you know, I'm going to make that 10-footer for par. I'm probably going to make it 30% of the time. And if I'm putting really great, you know, I'm going to make it. So, you know, you can live with that. You know, you can live with it with a 10-footer for par. And on the toughest golf course on the planet, you can live with a 10-footer for par. It's not a problem, you know. So just play, you know, got to play it that way. Don't try to be a superstar at this point. It's too dangerous. It's too dangerous. So Buddha Longchenpa has trained me, you know, to, you know, just keep doing this practicing. And I keep saying, I need to help people. And he said, nah, just, you know, just do what you're doing right now. We want to help people, but people are very well trained to act, you know, damsel in distress is the most dangerous thing in the world, period. You see all these women, you're being pulled down into emotionalism. You say, maybe I can help them. That's the most dangerous thing possible. Damsel in distress is almost guaranteed, you know, you're going to be pulled down into emotionalism. Your life's going to be just turned upside down and backwards. And before you know it, you're all emotional. So let the Holy Spirit take care of the damsels in distress. So let the Avatar take care of that. Later, I'm not gonna. That's way too. It's above my pay grade. That's like saying, you know, we've got a long hold of Augusta, man. I gotta, you know, get on in two. You know, Jack Nicklaus gets on in two. I gotta get on in two. You know, so I'm just gonna try to hammer my drive 300. You know, oh my God, I sliced it into the pine straw. Now I gotta, you know, hit a really great shot out of there. Oh no, I hit a pine tree. You know, now I'm really in trouble. And then, you know, I gotta hit another hard one. Ah, oh, I hit that fat, you know. I came off my right side too fast, trying to hit it too hard. I hit it fat, went 120 yards, and now I have like 180 over the water. What am I going to hit now? Four high, you know, it's like wham, oops, you know, I didn't quite hit it far enough. It's rolling back into the water. So one, you know, two, three, four in the water, five, hitting six, hitting a wedge back here, you know, six over the water. You know, I'm probably duffing that one in the water again. That's seven. I'm hitting eight. Finally, you know, get that on. Just playing safe away from the pin, so I'm on an eight. And now I'm, you know, trying to not three putt. I'm probably three putt, 9, 10. You got 11. You get an 11. You got 11 on your car. Just like that. Guaranteed. That's how it works. Guaranteed. You got just got an 11 on a par five. And then, you know, what's your mindset going to be like then? You're just like, I'm an idiot. You know, then you start getting all emotional. Instead, you say, I'm just hitting a 240 off this par 5. So 240, that leaves me with 275 to the hole. And so I'm just going to, well, let's see, what do I want for my third shot? What do I feel comfortable with? You know, hitting into this thing. Maybe 52 degree wedge. So I want to leave myself about 90 yards. And depending how I'm swinging it, and so 270, let's say, minus 9, it's 180, so you want to hit it 180, let's say, 180, and so that would be, you know, just take a 4 hybrid and hammer a 4 hybrid pretty good, nice good swing, goes about 180, now you've got like a 90 yard shot in with a 52 degree wedge it onto the green in a safe place, so you're on in three. So now I just lag the ball down near the hole, and now you got like a, you know, 7-foot putt for par. And, you know, being Augusta, you might miss it. So you then tap in for a bogey on the drive. Oh, no, you got a 6 bogey. Okay. No, not a problem. It's not an 11. Wow. Don't have my rain jacket. Wasn't supposed to rain. shit. They're about ready to kick off the football game, and it's pouring right now. It is pouring. they said it would be clear. Well, it'll probably stop. It's funny. That is funny, because they're just getting ready to kick it off right now. This is nasty. That's great. Make it nasty game, you know. This pig skin is just popping out all over the place. Rumbling. So I was just showing you, you know, the mind process. I'm looking at this, you know, the damsel in distress thing. Well, I got to just do everything possible. I got to hammer this drive 300 yards. You're going to just get, your game's going to fall apart. That's not your game. That's not your game. Let's say there's just stick within the shots you know you can hit. Figure out what are the shots I can hit, I'm really confident about, and then plot around those shots. So you, let's say you got a par 3 that's like 220 or something. You say, I don't really have that shot, you know, 220. So you might say, okay, let's just, how would you do that? Just hit a hybrid 180 and then use a 9-iron just for 40 yards, just bump it up there. You might get it up within, you know, 20 feet. And then, you know, take a run at it and tap in for a bogey. I mean, it's a nasty, nasty, treacherous hole. You know, just take a bogey on it. You know, make sure you get that bogey. One over par. And so, you know, keep the bleeding to a minimum. You know, you can't be bleeding out there, as they call it. You just can't be bleeding out on the golf course. The more you bleed, the bleeding gets worse and worse and worse. You can't stop it. It's really tough to stop the bleeding out there. I mean, Jordan Spieth yesterday, classic example, in Sony Open in Honolulu, Oahu, Hawaii, Hawaii. That's a Hawaii. Hawaii, Hawaii, something like that, I don't know, double I. Jordan Spieth shot a 65 to lead the tournament, tied the lead, and he's interviewed after. He says, my game, I really have it together, I really feel like I got it together. I feel like I can go out there and shoot 60, 65, 64 every time I go out. I really feel that way. Wow, this is a downpour right now. This is a downpour. Listen to it. So he was just feeling like, on top of the world, like I got my game together, so much together now. I'm looking at a 65 every day, go out there. He said, I can do it on this course, I can shoot 65 every day. Well, where's Jordan Spieth after Friday? He is actually flying back home to get in his RV and get ready for the next tournament somewhere. He missed the cut. He went from leading the tournament to missing the cut. That is very rare. That very rarely happens. He shot a 75. He shot a 5-over, 75. How did that happen, you see? How did that happen? Wow. The bleeding, he couldn't stop the bleeding. He said just the weirdest round of golf he's ever shot. Every ball, every place, he said every shot was in a bad position. You know, a terrible position. He just kept putting himself out of position the whole way through. And causing bogey after bogey, and then Rory Sabatini, he was doing great, and then he had like three triple bogeys in a row to miss the cut also. He was like one behind the lead. I think he hit balls in the water three holes in a row. It was crazy. I didn't watch it, but I just saw read up on it, you know. And he couldn't stop the bleeding. Neither of those guys could stop the bleeding. These are like some of the best golfers in the world. Spieth was number one in the world for quite some time. He couldn't stop the bleeding out there. It's unbelievable. Because he's getting greedy. He's getting greedy. He said, oh, I got to shoot another 65. You got to shot a 65. Forget about it. Go out there. What are my numbers I want to hit? Where do I want to put the ball? What's going to give me the best chance to make par, par, par? And then you're going to make a few birdies. Make a bogey-free round, get two or three birdies, and you're 8 under par or 9 under par, and you're 2 shots off the lead going into the weekend. You know, instead he's going home because he got overconfident. Wow. I've never heard a golfer talk that way. He said, I think I can shoot 64, 65 out here every single day. That's how I feel. I said, uh-oh. He's jinxing himself. Man, that is not good, what he said. And lo and behold, boom, look what happened to him. You'd think you'd be smart enough by now to not say that, man. Wow. He should have just said, well, I'm really grateful, you know, that I hit some good shots. I was in some good positions out there. So I was able to capitalize on. But this golf course can really bite you if you're not careful. So you got to be really focused on, you know, putting your ball in the right position and just be patient out there, you know. That's what he should be saying. He jumped the shark on that one like unbelievable. Not surprised. I said, where's Spieth? I'm looking. He's waiting. I said, what? 10-shot swing or 11-shot swing in one round. Holy cow. So, I say, look, you shoot around, good range. Again, I put myself in some really good positions, gave myself some really good looks, played really smart to my numbers, and made a few putts out there, you know, and it was an excellent day at the office, and, you know, tomorrow's another day at the office. Now I'm going to, you know, focus on, you know, putting my ball in a good spot, give myself good looks, and just be, you know, understand the difficulties of the course and, you know, stay away from them. But wow, amazing, just amazing. Same thing here, you know, with spiritual situation. You know, you gotta know your limitations and then play to those limitations. You know, damsel in distress is not the right thing to do. It is not the right thing to do. We all love to be the white knight, you know, kind of thing.